Hi everyone, I'm Da Guang from NVIDIA, and it's my honor to present our intense paper on deep hierarchical multi-label classification of chat secretary images. So here's the outline. I will start with the motivation, then the hierarchical disease structure we used in our chat secretary classification, and then the data set, and followed by our proposed method, then finally with our result. So first, why hierarchical? Because we find when the radiologists are diagnosing chest x-ray images, they may disagree on similar labels, for example, the mass and the nodules. For this, they often disagree on that. But we find that the radiologists may agree on high-level disease patterns. For example, still for this mass and nodule, they may very likely they are saying, OK, there are some high-intensity cluster there, and there exists a lesion area. But they will not agree, OK, this is a mass or nodule. So we want to use the clinical taxonomy and the ontology, because we find that that's actually natural organization for radiologists. In fact, we feel this is instead of just in addition to the ground truth labels, this is actually what's in the radiologist's mind. They learned this from their experience and also from the textbook, but we never included into our deep learning training. And at the bottom, you can see there's this one example, child and the parents class. For example, for chest x-ray, they find, OK, there are some pulmonary disease. And then they find, OK, let's define this disease as the scarring. So we find that this may help teach and train the classifier models. And by learning the parents class may improve the child class performance. This could also fit very well with radiologist decision process in diagnosis. They may find, OK, something is wrong at this region, then decide what's the subcategory disease. In terms of the research, these hierarchical methods have been explored in previous work, but mainly for the natural images. And that's only for the multi-class classification. For us, we are doing chest x-ray classification of multi-label problem, because each chest x-ray may have multiple disease exist in the image. To the best of our knowledge, there's little or no work in medical imaging analysis. And this is particularly true, this is particularly true for multi-label problem. So this is an example of the human disease network from the literature. You can see this is very complicated. So instead of starting from such a big network of more than hundreds or thousands of disease, we want to start with something more trackable problem. So that's why we choose the chest x-ray. We find the chest x-ray has a manageable number of observable disease pattern, and the chest disease are often related with each other. The data set we used is called PLCO. This is a public released data set from released by the National Cancer Institute of US. This data set has 14 disease labels annotated by the radiologist. So this one is actually quite different from the other public data set like the CHEST-14 or the data set of MIMIC. Those data sets, their annotation are from extracted from the radiologist report from using the NLP method. So we have already found that their annotation is not 100% accurate. So this data set, it has 198,000 chest x-rays collected from 71,000 patients. And one-third of the images are with abnormality. This is the disease, hierarchical disease structure we used in our method. This disease structure is based on the PLCO taxonomy and the Folios method. This is different from computer vision task. Like I said, this is a multi-label classification, not a multi-class classification. But we want to claim that our approach is general enough. It's not specific to any one taxonomy. This is the one we use. You may find other, you can prune it or update it with more disease. So that's, as long as it makes sense for following the clinical knowledge, that's fine. So from here, you can see at the top right, you can see the mass and nodule, they will belong to the same subcategory of pulmonary nodules and masses. So this one will be siblings of each other. Previous approach trains only on the leaf nodes for chess X-ray classification. That's chess X-ray classification. They only care about the bottom ones, like the scarring, distortion, cardiomegaly. I do not list all of them here, but mainly for chest 14, there are 14 diseases there. And they can easily add some high-level disease by adding more leaf nodes. But in this way, they still ignore the relationship between disease. For us, we want to use the true hierarchical model, incorporate the clinical taxonomy in both training and prediction. When we construct the hierarchical disease structure, that's actually, we follow one criterion. So just to explain a little bit about what we have done, this at the bottom, these are the leaf nodes. These are the annotations we got from the data set. And then we constructed, we add these labels to the ground truth based on the hierarchical disease structure. These are added following one criterion. The parent node is positive if at least one of its children is positive. For example, here, if scarring is positive, then we will assign the pulmonary and the abnormality as positive. So I think that's quite natural for the to humans. And then on the right side, if we want to adapt it to the network, we want the network to respect the hierarchical relationship. That means one, we are parents' probability are greater or equal to their children's. For example, at the bottom right, you can see the one predicted probability. That's just a pruned tree. So you can see the abnormality. It has higher probability compared to the pulmonary and the cardiac abnormalities. So I think that's also quite intuitive to humans. OK, when we design this tree structure, if each node can be treated as a conditional probability, so at the bottom here, take the scarring as an example, this node will represent the probability of P scarring given the pulmonary. And then this pulmonary will be P pulmonary given the abnormality. So this, in this way, we are defining it as a conditional probability. Previous method, they are all using it as the unconditional probability, that's a P scarring. Here, I'm showing here this, it's very easy to convert from our definition, the conditional probability, to the unconditional probability by taking a product of the probabilities. For example, here, this P scarring will be equals to P scarring given the pulmonary, multiplied the P pulmonary given the abnormality, and the multiply the P abnormality. So it's actually this line. So each node, its unconditional probability is the probability of itself and all its ancestors. In terms of the method, we train our network using a two-step training procedure. The first one, we trained the network with, first training it with the hierarchical label conditional probability. Then we fine-tune this network with the hierarchical label unconditional probability. So just to explain it more, at the bottom right, you see this is the backbone network we are using. This, we are taking the convolution layer of the DenseNet 121. Then we add a fully connected layer with 19 nodes. Each node represents corresponding to one node in our disease tree structure. And at the top here, I'm just taking a diagram here, is each node represents one node here. So thinking about that previously, people are just taking a cross entropy, kind of the one easy way is take a sum of the cross entropy of all the nodes here. So for us, for the conditional probability, we are taking a sum of the cross entropy of the selected node. So the conditional probability for each node is a cross entropy between the P, let's also take the scarring as an example. So it's a P scarring given the pulmonary abnormality and the versus the ground truth. So we are taking a sum of the node only when its parent label is positive. So for example, here is this one, the black nodes, it represents a positive. So it will, the blue region will represent the activation of our loss. These two nodes, because their parent is negative, so these two nodes, the cross entropy, will not be used in the training. This method has been used in the computer vision task already. The advantage here is the first, this conditional probability is easier to train because of the conditional. And also, this model only needs to discriminate across the siblings. It does not need to discriminate itself with some node, some disease that's relationally far away. The disadvantage is that there are less negative samples to train from, because if this node it has a negative sample, if one image has a negative sample in this node, it's very likely it may not be included in any of the training. Then after training this is actually we just changed the laws. So after we train this network, we fine-tune this network with the unconditional probability loss. So this is the unconditional probability loss, the unconditional probability case. So at the bottom right, it's still the same network. Then right now, for this one, we are instead of just training with partial of the of the nodes cross entropy loss, we are taking a sum of the cross entropy loss of all the node. They start with the conditional probability model, and we train it directly on the unconditional probability. So for the loss for each node will be the cross entropy of p scarring, still taking scarring as an example, versus the ground truth. Just to recall, our p scarring, this probability is multiplied product of the probability of this node itself and all its ancestors. And in this way, we are training all labels for every sample. The advantage for this unconditional probability is expose more negative samples for every label. And it makes full use of the data set and give the model global sense while preserving the hierarchical relationship among labels. The disadvantage here is there are some mathematical challenges of optimizing the product of classifier output nodes. Just to recall here, the cross entropy is computed as the probability product of multiple nodes. So here are actually three nodes already. It may be more. So when you come to this product of multiple nodes, it may cause some numerical instability. This is because multiplication of several conditional probability may cause floating point underflow issue. So we derived a method to use the logits directly to calculate the cross entropy loss in a more stable manner. So at the bottom here, you see this is our product of the probability. After some derivation, you can find the detail in our paper, but it's I would say it's a very straightforward derivation. You will find we can write it as a sum of the cross entropy loss of each node. This Lm prime is the cross entropy loss of each node itself, not a product anymore, plus this gamma. This gamma has this long equation, but this one still is very easy to implement. So in this way, this one we are computing the cross entropy loss of one node. So TensorFlow, PyTorch, or any packages, they can handle it very well already. Then we take a sum. So in this way, we are not using any product of multiple nodes anymore. So we are using just a sum of each node. Here, all our experiments are developed with NVIDIA's Clara AI platform. This Clara AI platform is a collection of toolkits. Right now, it mainly contains two parts. The first one is the Clara Train SDK, and the second part is the Clara Deploy SDK. As NVIDIA, we want to provide help everyone to build and deploy AI solutions in clinical workflow, and also in the clinical research. We want fast training, fast deploy, and this one, you can find more details at the bottom here. We just released the second version. So it's built on all the cool technologies, including NVIDIA's like CUDA and cuDNN, and also like the others from the from Google, Microsoft, Amazon. In terms of the training, we have 70% for training and 10% for validation, 20% for testing. The hyperparameter search were performed on NVIDIA's cluster with V100 GPU. And the training is done on 8 GPUs for about 2.5 hours and the batch size of 384. And for each network is trained with 450 epochs. We want to claim that our performance improvements comes from the algorithm development with the help of both NVIDIA's hardware and our Clara AI platform. You can see at the bottom, this is another benchmark, but you can see at the bottom, this Tesla V100 we are using. It's actually 44 times faster than the CPU right now, and also I think that's common sense to all the audience here, but you can see it's even faster than full Tesla K80. So in this way, I won't say that this speed can be higher if we train it with DGX 2 or the latest version of our SDK or the latest version of our GPU hardware. So here is the result. I showed the model AOC and the average precision comparison. At the bottom is this fine-tune. It means our two-step first train with the conditional probability, then fine-tune it with the unconditional probability. And for the top two, these two are training these two networks independently. And at the top, these two means the binary relevance. For the leaf, it means it's just the training with all the ground truths originally from the data set. And that's 14. And then for this BRR, that's training with all the 19 nodes. So in terms of for all the numbers, you can see our conditional probability, this line already is already better than all the previous baseline method. And our final method is essential to boost the performance. And our unconditional probability trained from the scratch is harder to train, and it need to be boosted off from the conditional probability model. And we want to claim that this, to the best of our knowledge, this result get the highest reported AUC for this PLCO data set. Here I compared our numerical instability handling this method comparing with some baseline. This one is called rescaling, the previous method. They simply just rescale the product of probability to larger than 10 to the minus 7. We find that this rescaling method, it actually harms the performance no matter whether it trains from scratch or trains from the conditional probability model. And here's the result of detail. We compare our final result with the traditional method of the binary classification. And we find we have higher AOC than the baseline for all the labels. And all this finding is actually statistically significant. And our final result actually find more improvements on labels with lower prevalence. For example, this label disease number 9 and also disease number 17. They are having just 10 images in the testing side because this is the data set the PLCO gave us. Okay, about the future work, we want to deal with the incomplete labels. So this right now, all the labels are actually, we deleted some images with incomplete labels. So the second one is we want to train with several data sets together. There are several data sets, although their annotation are not accurate enough, but still we find, okay, this one, we may get some help from this data set. So the third one is we want to create some specific block for every branch. Right now, all the diseases are sharing one backbone network. So we want to see whether we split them will help us. Also, the last one is applied to segmentation problem. I think it's quite intuitive. So this one just construct the disease structure. We can easily apply it to there. OK, thank you, and welcome any questions.
So we have time for questions.
Hello. Yeah, thanks. The PLCO dataset contains a lot of very low quality, very old chest X-ray scanned films.
Yep.
Did you notice any problems with that?
We noticed this problem, but to be fair, we just take all of them into anything we have into our training and the testing. We did not do any bias. And so far, we find, of course, our accuracy is affected by those low-quality images. But we do not, that's already giving us state of the art. So I think that's our next step. I did not list it here, but I'm thinking about maybe we can find some way to improve the image quality.
So I think we have no idea about state of the art for this data set. We don't know the AUCs of radiologists on this data set.
That's actually a good question. Yeah, for this one, we don't know what's our upper limit yet. So this one, as far as I know, there's no official split of the training and the testing. We find everything we can find and see most of the state of the art right now they are claimed is from Siemens.
Yeah, but I think in general, we have to be careful with using this term state of the art, because we have a number that's a little bit higher than another publication. I think we've also worked with this data set. Radiologists on some of these classes have a much higher AUC than what you are reporting here. And since we don't have that data yet, we should be careful with saying this is state of the art.
Okay, thank you for the suggestion.
Thank you for the presentation. I have a very simple question.
Sure.
Did you try to train the model with the two losses at the same time in order to get improvement from the two losses in one training?
That's good. That's a good question. Yeah, we tried, and we actually tried more than that with weighted and unweighted, try to handle the bias and also try to add them together with some weighted. And this way, we find this give us the best performance.
Just a quick comment.
Sure.
I think there is an article in the beginning of this year appeared in Nature Medicine, which is doing more or less the same thing as you do.
Yes.
So you'd better dig the literature a bit.
Sure. One thing I want to mention is this paper is, when we submitted, is earlier than what you are talking about. And I will be very happy to get the paper you are talking about offline. Thank you.
Other questions? Maybe I have one in the meantime. So in your paper, you compare the performance for the fine tune with and without the numerical stability. And it's very close in terms of performance. So does it really happen a lot in practice that this probability vanishes? Have you looked into that?
Yeah, we find, in fact, in our paper, if you look at the table, it's actually larger than I just showed. It's when we are training with the raw, with the just the native way, naive way, just using the product, then we find that the performance is actually worse than even than the baseline. So we look into the problem and find, okay, there are about several images are having this issue. I don't know, can't remember the percentage, but there are several, and we find this should be easy to classify. Then what's the reason we find that this is one of the reason, at least.
One last question. No, so let's thank the speaker again. Yeah.